For this video, it's really important that you understood the previous video where we looked at the exploit and figured out how to leak an address of a JavaScript object. And you should have a basic understanding of how a JavaScript object looks like in memory with inline properties and the butterfly. Because in this video, we will use the same bug from last time but turn it into a memory corruption. This series on browser exploitation is supported by SSD secure disclosure. Check out the description for more information. You probably wonder, how can we turn this address leak now into something that allows us to compromise the JavaScript engine? Well, it's not as easy as a simple buffer overflow where you get directly control over the instruction pointer. The bug we abused in addrof gives us some capabilities, but now we have to slowly turn them into more. So let's have a look at fakeobj. Saelo describes a different bug in his FRAG paper attacking JavaScript engines, but also introduces a addrof and fakeobj primitive. What addrof does we already know, but let's see what he says about fakeobj. The fakeobj primitive works essentially the other way around. Here we inject a native doubles into an array of JS values, allowing us to create JS object pointers. Remember this graphic explaining how JS values are stored? 32-bit integers were stored with this format where the highest bytes were hex FFFF and doubles were in this range. And that's also how we found them in memory. However, when you add a JavaScript object into an array, then you store a pointer, so the address to that object. So if addrof uses this bug to read the pointer to an object as a double, could we also reverse that so that a double is interpreted as a pointer to an object? That's exactly what we want to do now. Let's copy addrof and change the name to fakeobj. Our value we pass in would now be a double that we want to become a fake pointer. So now remember the issue. The bug was that this jittered code here will keep treating the array as an array with doubles, even though the last index to string function assigned an object to it, which turns the array into an array with contiguous and stores the pointer to our object in the array. So we abuse that now. In here, instead of reading, returning the first value as a double, we write our target double into the array. We should rename the function now addrof_setter. And in the evil last index to string function, we now assign an object to the array. And instead of returning the double representation that came from the jittered addrof_getter function from before, we actually want to return the real first element from the array. So it's pretty clear what will happen now. We have an array with doubles. Then we jit code that writes a double of our choice into the first element of that array. Nothing special here. It was a double before as well. Then we prepare this toString function and call addrof_setter again. This will execute the regex, which will call toString, and which will assign this object to the first element of the array. Now the JavaScript engine will turn the array with doubles into an array with contiguous and places a pointer to this new unnamed object into the array. But after that, our jittered code continues and still thinks we have an array with doubles, and thus it will write the double of our choice into the first element, overwriting the pointer that was set when here the object was assigned. It's kind of like a type confusion now. At the end, we return the first element of the array. Like I said, the toString function that assigned the object turned this array into an array with contiguous, but we overwrote the first element with our double. And if that double was chosen to look like a pointer, JavaScript will think the first element in the array is pointing to a JavaScript object. Let's try this out. Let's try to craft an object with this. I will use LLDB again for JSC, and to run, I pass in our test.js with the addrof and fakeobj function, but also use the option minus I to also get an interactive JavaScript prompt. So, how do we do this? To keep it simple, I decided to create a test object with a single property x, and that x is a simple integer. Let's look at it in memory. We describe test, get the addrof the object, control C, and print 4 64-bit hex values from that address. So the first 32-bit were some flags, the next 32-bit were the structure ID. Together they are a JSL header. Then we have the butterfly, which is null, followed by the inline property x, which we set to a 32-bit integer 1. And now let's try to fake such an object. And this is super clever. Of course, I didn't come up with this, I got this again from Saelo's paper. We can abuse the fact that the first few properties on an object are inlined into the object itself and not placed into the butterfly. Let me show you. Here I create an object that I will call fake, because it will help us to craft a fake object. And just for a start, let me create three properties, A, B and C. Now we describe it, get the address and look at it in memory with LLDB. So here again we have the flags, the structure ID, the butterfly and the integer properties inlined. So the address of fake points here. Now think about our fake object function. It will write a double into an array and possibly interpret it as a pointer to an object. So we could, for example, use address of to get address of fake, and when we plug it into the fake object function, we would get back the fake object. Quick test, and that works. It looks like we got an object back and it has the same properties A, B and C. But here comes the trick. We can fully control the double that is interpreted as a pointer. So what would happen if we add a tiny bit to that double value, which is the address of fake? Just add a little bit so that the pointer is now shifted forward and pointing here. If we then use fake object function, it would think that this is a JS object. That makes sense, right? However, this does not look like an object. This here would have to be the special flags, and this would have to be a structure ID. This would be the butterfly, and this would be the inline properties. But we control these property values with this object fake, so we could try to craft a valid object now. Let's try to do that. First, the flags with the structure ID. As you know, the structure ID defines what kind of properties exist on an object. So if we want to fake the test object with the X property from earlier, we need to use exactly the structure ID from the test object. Here's again our memory of test, which we can use as a blueprint that we want to copy. This is what we basically want to copy as a properties on the fake object. So how do we get the structure ID of our test object during execution of the exploit without using describe, because we don't have that function in the browser? Well, we know already that you create a new structure and get a new structure ID every time you add a different property on an object. We can abuse that to easily guess a valid structure ID. We basically create a lot of these test objects with the X property, but also an arbitrary other property to force new structure IDs that all have that X property. We basically spray test objects. If we execute that loop and look with describe at the last test object that we created, we see that it has the X property and it has this arbitrary other property. But most importantly, it has a huge structure ID. So if we randomly pick a structure ID of like hex 1000, we should be very certain that we get one of those test objects. I mean, theoretically, this could also fail and it could so happen that the structure ID we choose was not our target test object, but we can really increase the probability with just spraying many objects. Okay, so basically we want to craft the 64-bit value. We want to keep the same flags as a blueprint test object, but also use a high structure ID. I use Python again to do the conversion stuff and get the double representation. So this double should be now a valid JSL header for our fake object. So we assign it to the A property, but when we check and compare the memory, we notice that somehow there is a 1 that shouldn't be there. Turns out that the NaN encoding for JS values actually says, the scheme we implemented encodes double precision values by performing a 64-bit integer addition of the value 2 to the power of 48. That's hex 1000 and so forth. So if JavaScript will add that to our value, we have to subtract the value first. So here we get the new double. Assigning that and checking memory again, now it looks correct. Next we have the butterfly, and we need it to be 0. But how can we do that? If we want to create this property .c down here, we need to create a property b here as well, and we can't write a 0. Integer 0 would still have the FFF, and even a null would actually be hex 2. Well, for now let's create a property, but we come back to it in a second. The third property on our fake object would become the first property on our fake test object, so the .x property. And this we can just set to something cool, how about 1337. Okay, let's have a look at it in memory. Examine memory, there we go. This looks promising. Our fake JSL header looks really good, and this is our faked x property. Only problem is the butterfly. That ideally should be 0. But this turns out to be super easy. We can just delete the property b on our fake object, and when we look at the memory again, we can see that it's now null. Now let's place that all into our test.js script. We have the loop to spray structure IDs of our test object, then we create the fake object that we target, we set the properties so that they look like a fake test object, and then we use the addrof to get the double representation of the address from the fake object. Let's look at the memory again. So this double is this actual address, which means we want now to get a double that is just shifting this address a bit forward, 16 bytes in fact. So we can use Python again to convert this shifted address to the double representation, and here we go. Now we copy it and try to use fake object function. Hex equals to fake object of this double. Apparently that returned an object. So let's see if this object has a property x. It does, it's 1337. Let's describe it. And look at the address. JavaScript Core thinks now that hex is an object here, but those are actually the properties of our fake object. This means we can change the C property, so the third property of our fake object, into, for example, a string LiveOverflow. Then this, of course, also means our hex object now reads a string from its X property. Maybe this seems now a bit useless to you, but imagine the power you have now. You can craft arbitrary JavaScript objects and you control their internal class properties down to the memory level. For example, this allows you to craft a JavaScript array and control the butterfly pointer. You could point that pointer anywhere and act as if there was a butterfly. Okay, but it's still not code execution. But the question you should ask yourself now is, what object could we fake that increases our capabilities? Something that gives us even more power. And that process of thinking about faking different kinds of objects and experimenting with this is exploitation research, or generally security research. This would be our next step now, if you were a researcher doing this for the first time. However, we are noobs, so we still have not reached those state-of-the-art exploitation levels, and of course many researchers have already done that and documented it. So we can look again into Linus's exploit and see what he does with this. First, he sprays a float64 array in the same way we sprayed our test object. So that structure ID, hex5000, will be a float64 array with a very high probability. Then he also sprays a few WebAssembly memory objects, prepares some WebAssembly code, and here he prepares a fake JSL header. He is using here the in64.js library from Saelo, which we ignore for now. It will just create a fake JSL value like we did with Python. Let's focus on what we do recognize, and that is for example here. Here he creates a new object that he calls wasmbuffer, and the first property is the fake JSL header, like the first property A of our fake object we set to our fake JSL header. Looking at how he constructed that, we can see that it is using the structure ID hex5000, so it looks like he wants to create a fake float64 array. The second property would be the butterfly, and then some other properties. Later he deletes the butterfly again because he also wants here to have zeros, which seems weird for an array because usually arrays use the butterfly, but he does another trick. Then we see our first address of. So here he gets the address of wasmbuffer as a double, and then he uses the in64.js library again, which does all this double to integer conversion and stuff, basically what we did with Python. And so he takes that address, which was a double, creates a 64-bit integer from it, and then adds 16. So he's shifting that pointer a bit forward. The same way we did with our fake object. This is now the address of the faked float64 array. After that, you see he uses the library code again to turn that address back into a double and then passes the double to the fake object function. So now he should get a fake float64 array. But here's the other trick. Remember the WebAssembly memory object he sprayed? Well, actually, he's not at all interested in a float64 array. He wants a WebAssembly memory object. This while loop checks if the fake wasmbuffer is still not a WebAssembly memory object. How does this make sense when he deliberately chose a structure ID to get a float64 array? Well, he abuses the fact now that the two objects overlap. The fake wasmbuffer overlaps with the original wasmbuffer JSL header. And like we modified the .c property of the fake object, which affected the .x property of the fake test object hex, here he keeps incrementing the JSL header of the wasmbuffer, which affects the real structure ID of the fake wasmbuffer. And so in each iteration he checks now if the fake WASM buffer has turned into a WebAssembly memory object. He's basically brute forcing structure IDs in a safe way until he gets a WebAssembly memory object. And that's why he sprayed first the floats and then afterwards just a couple of WebAssembly memory. Spraying the floats is much faster to get a lot of structure IDs, so he can be sure to get such a fake object, and then WebAssembly memory structure IDs follow after that. Of course, this still doesn't explain how we get to arbitrary code execution, but we slowly get there. We understood another crucial part. Thanks again to SSD Secure Disclosure for supporting this series. Check out their website and learn more about the SSD Vulnerability Disclosure Program at ssddisclosure.com.